Topic volumetric analysis. Here we will discuss about the how the volume of the substances we measure it. So it is by definition we speak. It is an analytical procedure based on measurement of volumes of reactive substances. Means two volumes of substances react each other. Then we find the volume other substances. Not volume. We also find the concentration also. So in this method, known volumes of two solutions are allowed to react like this one. Let us see through these examples. So here we have one solution A, one solution B. So in this one solution, so we know the standard solution. It's called a standard solution. A standard solution means we know its concentration. Okay, and this solution is going to react with the another solution B. So when this solution B is going to react here. We know the volume of the solution, but we don't know the concentration of the solutions. Okay, so both are reverse. Here we don't know volume. Here we know the concentration. Here we don't know the concentration. So this is the situation over here. Then after the reactions, so we find the concentration of this solution B. Okay, using stoichiometric principles. Which are the stoichiometric principles? That is the law of equivalence, mole ratio. So all these, with the help of these things, we can find out their concentrations in terms of normality or molarity, whatever. Okay. So all these topics we are going to study in a topic, one common topic. The name of that common topic is called as titration. So what is titration? So titration is a technique or procedure in which volume, strength or normality of a one solution which will exactly react with a definite volume of another solution of known concentration, similarly like a previous ones. So we know the normality of one solution, but we don't know the concentration of another solution. We know the volume of a known solution, but we don't know the volume of the known concentrations. Okay, so with the help of titration, how we can see we can do this experiment, we see here. So this is your burette. Okay, this is your burette. So in this burette, some calibrated scale is there. So in that case, some known concentration is kept here. This is the known concentration. So concentration may be acid or base. This is called as titrant. So this concentration kept here, known concentration is called as titrant. Okay, this is the flask. So in this flask, we have a unknown concentration. It can be acid or it can be base. Anything can possible. Okay, so we can measure this volume of this solution present in the flask. So this concentration is called as titrant. So we have two new terms. That is, one is titrant and second is titrate. So another name of titrate is analyte. So we have to remember this different terminology used in the titrations. So if you are taking in the burette, suppose acid, so you have taken the here base. If you are taking here base, you have to take here acid. So both should be opposite to each other so that the reaction will take place. Okay, so again we know this N1 V1 is equal to N2 V2. So N1 we know that, V1 we don't know, but here N2 we don't know, that we have to find out, and V2 we know that. Okay, so after the reaction we know the V1. So only problem is N2 we don't know. So here we can find the concentration using the principle, that is called law of equivalence, which says that the at the end point of the titration, the volume of two titrant reacted have the same number of equivalent. Means equivalent of acid, if equivalent of acid is equal to equivalent of base, or equivalent of base is equal to equivalent of acid, whatever is there. And we know the formula is very well, that is a number of milli equivalent is by 1000 equal to number of equivalent, or number of equivalent equal to milli equivalent. So these are the terms we know very well. So some more terms associated with this experiment is we are discussing here. One term is called as end point. So I just discussed after the reaction end point, we say the reaction has been over at the end point of a titration. So what is meaning of end point? So end point is actually, it is an experimental value. Means practically we can detect this value. Okay, or we can say it is a stage during the reaction. Reaction means reaction of acid with base or base with acid. So after the base, what will happen? They will react to each other and they become neutral solution. So when we can find out the neutral solution, when we can find out that neutral stage. So a stage during the reaction is just complete or observable physical change by indicators. So we can say the reaction has been complete by observing the indicator. So one more term we are getting is called indicator. So indicator tells the end point that occurs near the equivalent point. So only indicator discuss the end point has been occurred, means the unknown concentration is completely neutralized. Okay, one more term is the equivalence point. What is equivalence point? So equivalence point is end point is experimental value. So here equivalence point will be a theoretical value. See, theoretically and practically it is indeterminable, so we cannot determine the practically. So this we can actually achieve it, and this is attained during the titration, at which equivalent of titrate becomes equal to equivalent of titrant. So it is very difficult to achieve this value. So equivalent point come first, then end point come first. So the color change take place at end point, not at the equivalence point. So difference between end point and equivalence point is called as titration error. So this is the one big error that we always find during the titrations. So how this experiment work? So let us come to the previous point. So see here, now we know the terms indicator in end point. So suppose in this acid some sodium hydroxide has been taken. Suppose this is a base present in this burette. So you take here like a base, suppose, and suppose here it is present as a acid, suppose. Okay, so which N1 is unknown and here N is known. Okay, so N is known. So we know this concentration value. Here we don't know the concentration value. Now if you open the stopcock, so what will happen? This base will go into the solution. It will react with the acid. So after the reaction, what will happen? It becomes salt plus water. Okay, now this reaction is already substituted with the indicators. So here the reaction is already added with the indicators. So indicator is the substance or color which shows the shows the end point or which detect the end point. So okay, so what happens when base will react with the acid? It becomes salt plus water. Okay, so when it becomes neutral positions, okay, what happens? Indicator will show the colors. Okay, but due to presence of more acidic, okay, what happens? The color of the indicator is suppressed down, so it becomes again colorless. So this acid is, suppose you take colorless acid. Okay, so again you put some more base into the acid. So drop by drop put it, the all acid will be converted into salt. So final drop of acid will be there. So when you give slowly from the base to this point, what will happen? That acid will be completely neutralized. Okay, reacted. So after reaction, what happens? All acid will convert to salt plus water. So this become water, and this water contains indicators. So indicators will see it is a normally weak acid or weak base. So in that water it will disposes color. So at this time this become a sharp color. Color is very sharp, and we can identify, and that will give you the neutralization of this reaction. So initially whatever the value of the burette was there before base is going to the acid flask, so after the neutralization, just at the neutralization, whatever the volume of the this base is goes into the solutions, we will take the difference. That will give you the volume of this concentration. So we know the normality, so concentration, and now we know the volume. That is the final reading of the volume minus initial reading of the volume. Okay, so now initial minus final reading of the volume will give you the difference of volume. And here we know the concentration, here we know the volume, so we can find out the concentration of this acid. So this is the way for the analysis of doing titrations. Now see indicators. So indicators used to make the endpoint detectable, just we have seen by change of color. So indicator will say the endpoint of the color. Now, indicators, so many types. So we'll here discuss three type of indicators which will be discussed during the normally problems. So you have to keep remember which type of indicator has been used in problems. So normally external indicators are there, so they are not added inside the solutions during the reaction. So they are not added, they are added externally after the reactions. So like iron 2 plus versus potassium dichromate. So K4FeCNO, this is a reaction. So when iron plus is reacting with the potassium dichromate. So in this titration, so K4FeCN whole 6 act as external indicators. And Fe2ion, this will give you blue color solution. But if it converts to Fe3 plus ion after the reaction, it will not give you. So when it converts to Fe3 plus, when you add it, if suppose Fe2 plus is there, then blue color will be there. If they will not give blue color, then it will be your Fe3 plus ions. This means that give you your end point. So normally external indicators we are not using in our course. Now next teacher, internal indicators. So in internal indicators, indicators, so they may be added in the reaction mixer. So reaction mixer, you can add it, and at the end point, so they cause a visible change. Just like the previously we have seen it, we have sodium hydroxide in the burette, and the flask we have taken acid, suppose HCl. So in that HCl we have added some indicators. So that indicator will give you the end point. That is called internal indicators in the solutions. So this is the internal indicator in the solutions. So after the neutralizations, what happened, or at the neutralization points, or that is called end points, they will cause a visual change. How? So if you take iron 2 sulfate versus potassium dichromate, here we can use indicators like methyl orange, phenolphthalein, etc. So if potassium dichromate is acidic solution, so in acidic solution normally we are using methyl orange. You can use any one, phenolphthalein also. So in this they will show the color change. So that we will discuss about the color change and all these things in another topics. Okay, so but here it is used normally to as a internal indicators in this titrations. Okay, next is the self indicators. So in this type, one of the titrant or titrate or products act as a indicator. Means here titrant or titrate, both you are taking, so both can act as an indicator itself. There is no need of adding indicator from the outside. Okay, suppose in the titration of oxalic acid versus KMnO4. So here we have this may be titrant, this may be titrate, or this may be titrate, this may be titrant. So in either cases, this is acting as a self indicator. So color of the KMnO4 will change during the end point. So KMnO4 will change color, that it becomes purple color. Okay, so this is the purple color. So at the reaction, it becomes colorless. So after the reactions, so that give you your self indicator. So this is the self indicator is there. Okay. So now, see, we'll see the characteristics of indicators. So in characteristic of indicators, color change of the indicator must be clear. So a color change of the indicator must be clear, it should be clear and sharp. Sharp means it should be, the color should be, it is a pointed. You can identify this color, you can identify very clearly. You see, it looks like a very brilliant color. That it must be sensitive at equivalence point. Okay. Then pH range over which the color change take place must be such that to indicate when the reaction is complete. So this pH range over is also very important point. So every indicator has some pH range. So that range must, at that range is there, then only color change take place. If you are giving beyond this color, beyond this range, then the color change will not take place. So this range is also very important to identify the change of color. So how this range is very important? Suppose if you are using phenolphthalein as a indicator, so this indicator is not good indicator for the weak alkali titration. Okay, if you take here any strong acid, strong alkali, okay, or strong acid, then it is good one. If you take weak alkali, in that case what happens, hydroxyl ion of the weak alkali cannot shift the equilibrium. This is the point of equilibrium that we will study in topic, coming topic, that is called ionic equilibrium. So in ionic equilibrium chapters, we will study why, how weak base cannot shift the phenolphthalein, cannot shift the equilibrium. Okay, and the range of this phenolphthalein's end point is 8 to 10. So between 8 to 10, this range is very important, where the change take place, color change take place. Okay, so above the 10, if the pH is less than 8, if the pH is more than 10 means it becomes strong base. The color change will take place. If you are taking less than 8, then color will take place. Between 8 to 10, color will not take place. So this you have to keep remember. Methyl orange, so they also not good indicator for the weak acid titration region, because weak acid cannot shift the equilibrium. Okay, this is the one of the basic problem of the methyl orange that we will study during the ionic equilibrium. Same thing for this pH ranges of the end point is 3.1 to 4.4. So below 4.4, what will happen? It become more basic. Less than 3.1, it become more acidic. So acidic will give different color. After basic, it will give different color. So we have to know this range. Otherwise, it is very difficult to find out the neutralization. Okay. So we should know the pH of the solution also, and we should know the pH range of every indicators. Okay. That should be present at the time of neutralization. That range. One more thing, indicator do not give color at neutralization. It's very good. If the neutralization occurring between 3.1 to 4.4 or 8 to 10 like this one, then we won't get any color. It should be after this one or it should be before this one. Then only indicator gives color. This is a very important point to learn it. Now, on the basis of different titration, there are so many types of indicators. So we are not going to discuss everything. So like pH indicators, oxidation reduction indicators, adsorption indicators, like starch, universal indicators, metal indicators. There are so many indicators, but this is not in our course, so we will not discuss all these things. One important point during this one is titration is standard solutions. So standard solution is very important. So this will help you in titrating the titrate. A solution whose concentration is known. So for standard solution, we know the concentration. And this titrate is dissolved in standard solutions. So it is two types. Primary standard titrates and secondary standard titrates. What is primary? In primary, solutions can be prepared by weighing them directly. So here you weigh them and then you make the solutions. So like iron sulfate, ammonium sulfate, hypo, copper sulfate, silver nitrate, oxalic acid, potassium dichromate. So all these are primary standard titrate. Benefit is that their purity is very high. They don't contain any hydrate water. They have high equivalent weight and they are also readily available anytime. Then what is secondary? Standard titrant. So here, titrants whose solution cannot be prepared by weighing them directly. Here we are weighing them. Here we cannot prepare by weighing them. If you weigh them, then you prepare it, it will be a problem. Because what will happen? Solutions. So it cannot be prepared by weighing them directly. So they will react with substances surrounding them. So what we're saying, the solutions, if you make these solutions, then they will, what will happen? They will react with surroundings, means it will react with moisture, carbon dioxide, oxygen. Okay, it will cause a problematic. So their measurement will change. Like a potassium hydroxide, sodium hydroxide, HCl, H2SO4, KMnO4. So all these are secondary titrants and they will absorb these type of substances, moisture, CO2 and O2. So what will happen? This will give you titration error. So this, their solution is standardized by titrating them with the standard solutions. So first we have to make these solutions, then titrate them. So we cannot make directly. Okay. So this is one of the big limitation with the secondary standard titrants. Now how to prepare the standard solution? So preparation of standard solutions, it is prepared by dissolving an accurately weighed quantity of highly pure material. So first you weighed any quantity of highly pure materials and then you dissolve into the waters. That is called primary standard, and diluting to an accurately known volume is in a volumetric glass. So you take some 100 ml, you take some 2 gram like this one, so it will be 2 gram per 100 ml. So you can make this concentration. So this concentration will be present in a solution for a long time. If it is primary titrate, it will be long time. If it is secondary titrate, it can't be long time. Second titrate we made immediately. Now properties of standard solutions. Why we make a standard solution? What are their properties? Because their concentration is remain constant for months or year after preparations. So to eliminate the need for re-standardization. So once you make this solutions, it remains constant. It do not change. That is the one of the main property of standard solutions. Now it is 100% pure. Okay, little impurity is tolerable, like 0.01% to 0.02% kind of tolerable. It is also stable for drying temperature and also indefinitely stable to room temperature. So any temperature, drying temperature, room temperature, the standard solution must be stable. It should be readily available, or you can it should be readily available, means you can get easily in the laboratory. Okay, and we can give a reaction to the reactant. So easily available, stable, 100% pure, and although not necessary, they should have a high formula weight. We should not take the standard solution of low formula weight. Why? Because if you take large formula weight for the given number of moles, it reduces the error of weighing. So during weighing, there will be less chance of error in the solution. So this is the one of the important necessary point to consider. But it is not necessary, but normally we are taking the high formula weight. Secondary standard titrate is less accurate than the primary standard solutions normally. Why? Because in secondary titrate we get the so many errors of titrations, but in primary standard we do not get any titration. So we have to keep following some theoretical points while doing the experiments.